Councillor Mizzou, which I'm very pleased to come.
I'm Linda Roberts, line number WHaCC.
Hi, Holly Grant, Assistant Director of Children's Services.
I'm Jude Weston, the Acting Director for Health and Wellbeing.
Sam Garley, Commissioner for All Age and Dependents, and here to address item 9 on the agenda.
Sylvia, she's a lay member.
Paul Kerr, Medical Director.
Sharon Stokes, GP, long-term conditions.
Alan Moodle, lay member of the CCG. And Tran, Chief Plans Officer, CCG.
Jason Moxley, Assistant Director, Health and Care, Rural Health and Care Commission.
Simon Banks, Chief Officer, Rural Health and Care Commissioning.
Hello, I'm Sue Wells, I'm the Chair of Rural CCG.
Thank you very much. Apologies for absence.
Just the one chair, Councillor Tarkinshire.
Right, he's at the Rural Safeguarding Board, unfortunately, the two meetings clashed today.
And from Wirral CCG governing body, we have a number of apologies. Nesta Hawker, Lorna Quigley, Helen Downs, Simon Delaney, Lax Ariage, Bennett Quinn, Paul Edwards, and Karen Pryor, Graham Washington is also on leave. I apologise for the number of absences, which is partly due to the fact this is half term, but I can confirm that governing body is quorative.
Yes, and the council is for it as well with two members. The next item on the agenda is appointment and confirmation of committee chair co-chairs. So the way it was last year was that we had co-chairs, one from the CCG and one from the council. So are there any nominations, please, for co-chairs? Yes, please.
I'd like to nominate yourself, please.
Thank you very much.
And the co-chair from Wirral CCG will be the chair of governing body.
Thank you, Sue. Any declarations of interest? No. I'm sure everybody's had the chance to read the minutes of the last meeting. Are there any matters arising out of those minutes that are not on the agenda? No? Can I sign those minutes then as being accurate? So the Chief Officer's report, over to you, Simon.
Thank you, Chair. So this report was written, as it states, on the 26th of April. So it's written some time in advance in order to meet the needs of the committee cycles. There's some bits within this that we'll pick up on, or I'll ask colleagues to pick up upon. I presume it's actually been read by people, so that I'll just pick up any outstanding items. The meeting on the 10th of May with the other CCG chief officers and the regulatory bodies, because it's now NHS England and NHS Improvement, the same people in the same room from the same bodies. More or less a similar agenda around that in May as it was in April around the future of commissioning for maternity care, around the planning and contracting agreement. But also a little bit of a reminder to us that actually there is now going to be an obligation from April 2020 to offer people waiting for surgery more than 18 weeks obligatory choice, 26 weeks of choice of alternative provider. We've managed in the last year to eradicate 52-week waiting list. very, it's, you know, the team that we had from NHS England and NHS Improvements can be spread even thinner now because they're covering a larger patch, and there will be fewer of them over the course of the next year as the management cost reductions take hold within those two organisations. Just also in terms of the health and care partnership, the foreseeable future will be continue to be led by an health pickup, and work is going on around accountability frameworks and memorandums of understanding, strengthening the governance around that. The final message, I suppose, was huge attention to be paid to accident emergency delivery, urgent care delivery over the next few weeks. We've had a very challenging winter, that's continued into the spring, and where systems are challenged, there will be more intensive support from the regulatory bodies. The way it's worked previously is that the emergency care intensive support team has kind of gone into organisations, given them the diagnostic and moved on. They're reshaping it off for now, where there'll be more support for a longer period of time to actually make the changes happen. On the second page, it references under 3.1.2, top of page 14, 18 on, if you're using an iPad, the health and care partnership on the 8th of May, again addressed by Bill McCarthy, the regional director. But just a reminder of what the long-term plan is about. Firstly, long-term plan is about boosting out-of-hospital care and actually removing the historic divide between primary and community services. It's redesigning and reducing pressure on emergency hospital services, introducing same-day emergency care as an approach, about ensuring there's adequate flow and reducing long lengths of stay within hospital settings. Third, it's about giving people more control over their own health and more personalised care when they need it, because there's a real link to this, to the learning disability agenda, and to people with long-term conditions having greater control over the care when they need it. Fourth, increased digitalisation, so actually digitally enabled primary and outpatient care. This is not just for patients, but for the people delivering the services as well, and clearly we need to be careful where people don't have access to digital, and we need to make sure services are
federations and the local medical committee. The main topic of discussion now was around primary care networks, which comes as a national way forward that is not yet finalised and established, and there are still discussions going on. So it's an important time to just hold a discussion about it with our two GP federations and our local community.
Is that these aims, these themes were adopted last year, and we've had some and the NHS plan, which we all anticipated would be coming out, was delayed by at least a couple of months with a variety of national political developments involving us, the future of this country and Europe and the European Union, which delayed the publication of the long-term plan to the 7th of January of this year. Within days, then there's the planning guidance about what needs to be done for 1920, because you can't enter another financial, a new financial year without having a clear budget, clear aims, etc. So the one-year operational plans that we were required to produce very much followed on from NHS five-year rule review. Through the Healthy Wirral programme, all the partners agreed to act as one and submit one plan to the regulatory bodies. The ask in the guidance was lots of different organisational plans, and whilst clearly people plan internally for their own delivery, and it comes up under item 10 on this agenda about our response in terms of a business plan, our response to the business plan is to this operating plan. So we've acted as a system. So the Healthy Wirral plan is aggregated and from our intentions, is associated with the work we've done on financial recovery, but principally this is about creating a sustainable health and care economy in which we improve our performance against the constitutional standards and deliver safe and high quality care for populations we serve with good outcomes. The long-term plan
70% of money we spend is with NHS providers, so if we save money, we have to make a saving, and we take it from NHS providers, then we actually exacerbate their position, because they have to then save more to balance their books. You'll see the other numbers that the providers don't alter, so Wellesley's only make £13.2 million save at 3.5%, which is not without risk and a significant challenge for them, but I just wanted to be clear that people understood what the strategy is. The strategy is trying to generate £20 million of external funding from the centre to the rural system, and it will require more partnership work than we've seen previously.
Thank you, Mike. I think some training would be really useful, because I know how different NHS and council funding is. And it's when you use all those factors, I think it starts to get a little bit heavier even than it wants to start. Have you any thoughts about when that training might happen?
To make sure that in the next 2 months, I guess, because I'm conscious once we get to July, at least into the whole season, so we can
increasingly that would have to be through business cases demonstrating returns of investment, but I think the long-term plan itself and what we know we need to do on Wirral from other perspectives, they're very much being, you know, the givens for local interpretation. So it's about how we do deliver some of these within existing available resources and redesign those resources rather than necessarily disinvest. But it is a challenging position to take forward. It is ambitious given, as I said, we're not experiencing 6 to 8% growth in our resources every year on year like we did several years ago. So it actually means we need to do things on
very small summary of 420 at the bottom of that page, which sets out the issues in terms of financial risk and challenges for adult social play. Okay, we know from presentation Julie previously there are some issues around pressures and public health contracts going forward, and that's going to be managed from 2020 on. And equally, we've gone through the CCG numbers very summary level for 1920. So I think, despite the challenges, Chair, I think the pool fund, as set up, it was managed relatively well, I think, to end the year with that same kind of percentage problem phase, given all the pressures that we saw at the start of the year. Clearly, those challenges will continue, given the demands on all the services and the funding constraints that exist both locally and nationally. Happy to take any questions.
Thank you, Mike. Anybody have any questions for Mike? You've baffled us now.
Relaxing second.
Not at all. We're noting the report. And I think we're all out of way in the growing month and everything else which we're struggling with. But I think the wonderful innovative things that we're doing as well will help. So the next is the aged care housing scheme update, which is Simon.
Thank you, Chair. Just briefly, I'd just highlight a little bit of what extra care is, why we need it, and what we're doing to address that need. So, and it's quite a lot of detail in the report, but for those who may not have come across extra care before, the extra in extra care is the care that is available on an unplanned, unscheduled basis. So some people who may be living independently may be getting some support from domiciliary care agencies. Maybe that might be small in nature, it might be significant, but that is generally an assessed need and plan. And where things can become difficult for adults in those circumstances living with a disability is when they have like an unscheduled need, when something happens that they weren't expecting and the care isn't in the home at that point. And so having this background support, 24-hour available emergency or unplanned care is what's extra about it. But I tend to feel that whilst that describes some of the practical elements of extra care, it also does an awful lot to relieve social isolation, create opportunities for people to remain active, participating in the community, connected to community services, particularly health services. And so we think about how those links are being made all the time as we're looking at new sites and schemes developing. They are affordable rents, although there are some tenancies that can be of mixed tenure. Some people can share ownership or in certain schemes in Wirral. But generally the ones coming forward now are affordable rent schemes. Why we need it? I think I've said in the report that as far as the tools that are available to us determine, it's pretty clear that there's quite a gap in need for housing provision of this kind. As we go forward, we'll want to do some more detailed work because there's been a significant gap. We know we need to develop more extra care housing. As we get to more significant numbers of those developments, we'll want to do some more local research on the types of need going forward so that we really get the positioning of extra care right and we make sure there's sufficient available provision in Wirral. But certainly for the numbers at the moment, there's quite a big gap to fill, hence the drive to get up to 300 additional units by 2020. As I said, there's some delays, they're a bit more beyond our control because they're about government policy reviews that occurred a couple of years ago that held things up. But what we're doing to address those needs very much the extra care as more than just a building now, and that's a real thing to emphasise. Any questions?
Anybody? No. For me, Simon, we've been through this journey together, I think, and I'd really like to thank you for all the hard work you've put into the extra care work. For me, you know, it's about promoting independence and keeping people in the place they want to be for as long as possible. So, can we just note the report and we endorse this approach to extra care housing? Yes,
Chair.
Can I just add a comment to what you said? Thank you, Simon, for work on this. And this really is an example to me of why we need to work in an integrated fashion, as you say. NHS needs and social needs go hand in hand. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Simon. And the next is the World Health and Care Commissioning Single Business Plan. Simon?
I think I'll pick that up in Graham's absence. So, as I said earlier, the operational plan for the system, we've taken significant elements of that, plus what we also have to do as World Health and Care Commissioning, and produce a business plan for the